everyone. Is it on? Can you hear me?
Yeah, good.
I would like first to thank the organizing committee for inviting me here. I will give a presentation about how the gut microbiota and nutrition can maybe actually affect diseases in the brain, such as Alzheimer's disease. I'm a biologist and I work at the Food for Health Science Center in Sweden. It's located at Lund University. Don't manage to switch this. So we work with developing new types of healthy foods, so we try to optimize the health effects of foods by looking at different aspects of and food properties. So we are a transdisciplinary center, so we have people working in microbiology, food technology, food engineering, nutritionists, medical doctors also. And we try to have a very transdisciplinary approach to be able to optimize health effects of foods. And my main research focus is how different dietary factors affect the gut microbiota and how we can use modulation of the gut microbiota via foods to have increased health. And our main fields that we work in is in diseases such as the metabolic syndrome, obesity, type 2 diabetes, and atherosclerosis. And I'm especially interested in how different inflammatory processes in the body, and especially in the brain, can be modulated by the gut microbiota and the diet. So in our labs we have a test kitchen, we make baked breads and different type of prototype foods, and we have people coming in, healthy people, people with diseases, and we do dietary interventions then to test our new foods. We also perform animal models testing. And we can do cognition tests because quite many researchers now are very much interested in how the diet affects the brain. And I will show you a couple of examples of that later on. So I'll go through a little bit how how it can be that maybe our gut microbes can actually affect something so far away from the gut as the brain. And I will show you a couple of examples also on how the diet that we eat affects the gut microbiota and how we can use that knowledge to optimize health benefits of food, especially then in the fields of inflammatory processes in the body and especially in the brain. So and especially my focus is to really characterize more thoroughly how the diet that we eat affects the gut microbiota composition. And why that is important is because we have seen in just the past few years, as you heard previously, that this is very new research and we don't really know so much about how the gut microbiota is affecting health. But initially we found that, or many researchers over the world found that, in diseases located in the gut, such as Crohn's disease and inflammatory bowel diseases, there is a difference between the microbes that you have then in the gut compared to healthy people. And that sort of is quite logic, but then in just a few past 10 years, we have also observed that people suffering from obesity, type 2 diabetes, atherosclerosis, they also have a changed microbiota compared to healthy people. And lately, just quite recently, we also observed that patients suffering from Parkinson's disease, multiple sclerosis and autism, they also have a different microbiota compared to healthy controls. And these are diseases located in the brain, and it's quite hard to comprehend why microbes in the gut would be able to affect the brain. And one really important question here is this really what we see here in humans? Is this cause or consequence? Because it could be that people who are ill with diseases but that alters the microbiota as a second thing, and that the microbes are really just a consequence of the disease. But in fact, there is really quite a lot of evidence from animal models showing that the microbiota can really induce disease. And that has been shown for many of these diseases here. If you take a mouse and you remove all the bacteria, you make it germ-free, completely sterile, then it does not develop obesity. Even if you put it on a high-fat diet and you give it free access to food, it can eat as much as it likes and it still doesn't develop obesity or diabetes. So the same is actually true for multiple sclerosis, this brain disorder where you have destruction of different areas in the brain causing paralysis eventually. If you take a mouse model again there and make it germ-free, it does not develop MS. So it does indicate that you can really make quite nice fecal microbiota transplants to really induce certain diseases. What has not been known so much is about what the role of microbiota is in Alzheimer's disease. Just a few words about Alzheimer's disease. It's a neurodegenerative disease, so you get a gradual inflammatory process in the brain, an accumulation of different protein plaques. They are called beta amyloid and tau proteins, for instance. And it seems to create some quite a strong inflammatory reaction that eventually leads to neuronal cell death. And that gives you then the classical symptoms of Alzheimer's disease with the memory loss. But you can also develop personality disorder changes and some other symptoms as well. Risk factors that we know of is atherosclerosis and type 2 diabetes. But today we don't really know what actually initiates this disease. What initiates the accumulation of beta amyloid in the brain? What initiates the inflammatory process in the first place? There are some quite strong genetic predispositions in some families that really increase the risk quite greatly, but those are quite a small number of patients, and there's a large number of patients that don't have this sort of genetic predisposition. Instead, it's more sporadic, and it seems to be more of an environmental factor or factors that increase the risk of developing Alzheimer's, and that's what we really need to know a lot more about. So how can you then study the role of the gut microbiota in Alzheimer's disease? Well, I was contacted just a few years ago by a team in Switzerland. They work at the Technical University in Lausanne, Finland, in Lausanne, Switzerland. And Taufik Haraf, Theo Lasser, and Tristan Beaumont. They had come up with a quite clever idea to take their regular Alzheimer's disease mouse model and make it rederive it as germ-free. So they made this conventional Alzheimer's disease mouse completely sterile by putting it in a germ-free isolator. The experiments were performed by the postdoc Taufik Haraf. So this is just an example of what these germ-free isolators look like where you keep the mice. So they had mice that were just conventionally raised with a regular microbiota, but then these mice are genetically engineered to develop Alzheimer's disease, and they are called APPS1 mice. So they have mutations in some important proteins that increase their risk of developing Alzheimer's disease pathology in the brain. And then controls in these experiments are mice that are just wild-type Easter mates, so they are exposed to exactly the same environmental factors. They are in the same cage together with the little mates. And what Taufik and his colleagues found was that if you remove all the microbiota from all the bacteria in the whole body from these Alzheimer's mice, you can reduce Alzheimer's disease pathology in the brain by 70%. So we look on different proteins in the brain. So one of these is amyloid beta, and it was reduced 70% in the brain when you make the mice sterile. So it really indicates quite an important role of the gut microbiota for Alzheimer's disease progression. I should point out that, yeah, this is now published, so please, if you want more details about the analysis and the proteins that we looked at, you can have a look in the paper. But it's important to point out that the German mice were not completely protected from Alzheimer's disease. They still developed Alzheimer's disease, but they had a much slower progression of disease. So we were able to slow the progression of disease quite a lot. Then the Swiss team, they were experts in this animal model, but they did not have the facilities to perform microbiome sequencing. And that is available in my lab, so they asked me to look at the microbiota in healthy mice versus the Alzheimer's diseased mice. So that would be equivalent to looking in patients and comparing healthy patients with people with Alzheimer's disease. So I processed these fecal samples from the mice, healthy mice and Alzheimer's disease mice. What we do here in at Lund University is that we perform 16S rRNA sequencing of the bacterial genes, and then we use a MiSeq as a sequencing instrument to get the complete gut microbiota profile. And my PhD student, Nitaya Marubang, she performed this analysis, and what she found was that the gut microbiota is altered in the mice with Alzheimer's disease compared to their litter mates. So in this graph you see analysis of the microbiota at two different taxonomic levels. It's at the phylum level and the genus level. And we also analyzed the mice at three different time points when they were of three different ages. 1 month old mice and 3.5 month old mice and 8 months old mice. So the 1 month old mice are healthy. They do not show any presence of beta amyloid plaque in the brain. But the 8 months old are quite severely ill with disease. And what we observed was that in the younger mice, in the youngest ones, we don't see so much difference in gut microbiota between healthy and diseased mice. But then with age, there is a gradual shift in the microbiota between healthy and diseased mice. And in the 8 months old mice, we can see that the healthy mice have a gradual alteration with age in the microbiota, whereas the Alzheimer's disease mice, the oldest mice there, they don't seem to alter their microbiota with age as much. So this is probably due to their genetic makeup somehow. Their mutations in the APPS1 genes seem to affect the gut microbiota composition. And one big difference in bacteria that we see is Akkermansia. There were also some other bacteria that seemed to differ significantly between healthy mice and diseased mice. So we looked further on this data, and this is very small. We just put all the different microbes we found differed between the healthy and diseased mice and tried to identify bacteria that could maybe be correlated with more disease or with less disease, so have more like protective or harmful bacteria. We're still looking at this data, but we could see that maybe Akkermansia and Parabacter aureus seem to be associated with a lower amount of beta amyloid plaque in these mice. And then there are other bacteria, like Odorybacter, we found was quite strongly correlated with an increased amount of beta amyloid plaque in the brain. So currently now we're looking at also other mouse strains of this disease to see if we can find similar shifts in the microbiota. Then we next continued also to see whether we could maybe transplant the microbiota from diseased mice and compare it with healthy mice. So we took the microbiota from diseased mice and put it into a germ-free mouse, and then we compared how the disease progressed compared to if the germ-free mouse had gotten microbiota from a healthy mouse. And we could see a difference there, that there was the mice that were given microbiota from diseased mice had a quicker progression of disease than if you get a healthy microbiota. Mm. So it further indicates that the microbiota is indeed involved in Alzheimer's disease and is probably not just a consequence of disease. So we applied for an EU project to look further on these results, and it was granted 2 years ago, and we have also increased our cooperation network now to partners in Belgium and Germany, and other partners in Switzerland also. And our main goal in this project is to further look on can we develop maybe protective probiotic treatments against Alzheimer's disease. And we are mainly focused on prevention. I think we will have the highest rate of success by looking at prevention instead of treating a disease that has already arisen. So currently we're testing that, and we're also developing in parallel new types of biomarker tools and microscopy techniques to quickly map the microbiota that might be used for a quick identification of the important bacteria. And of course our main question also now is that, can we really go from mouse to man? Is our data relevant for humans as well? Because the mouse model is a mouse model, and we need to really address this in humans as well. So currently we're trying to look in the EU project, we perform different colonizations with specific single bacteria or 2, 3, 4 bacteria to see if we can slow the progression of the disease. And we also perform transplantation of human Alzheimer feces into geography mice and compare that with healthy donor bacteria. So no results yet, we're currently analyzing that. And then I'm also working in Lund to try and find which kind types of dietary factors that we could use to shift the microbiota into a more balanced microbiota and maybe suppress those bacteria that we see are maybe associated with disease and increase the ones that we think are beneficial. And mainly for the future in the autumn and in the next year, we have started collaboration also with a neurologist in the Ängelholm Hospital in Sweden, Maria Lankis-Valdö. She is an expert on Alzheimer's disease and frontotemporal dementia. And together with her, we will collect fecal samples from patients with Alzheimer's disease and frontotemporal dementia. Hopefully around 100 or 200 patients in a pilot study. And to compare that with healthy controls, which is always difficult to have a healthy control, but we're aiming for spouses in the study. So hopefully once we know whether this holds true also in humans, we can see which bacteria we need to change in people to maybe be able to prevent or delay the onset of disease. And currently we don't really know how it is, how can it be that gut microbiota are so important for this brain disorder. But there are some hypotheses out. There was one study published in 2013 in Nature showing the importance of inflammatory processes in the brain. They looked at this mouse model and knocked out a gene for something called the inflammasome, NLPR3 here, and see that can affect Alzheimer's disease pathology in the brain. We also think that it might be bacterial metabolites that are important, and also the barrier in the gut. So if you have a leaky gut due to a dysbiosis in the gut, it might affect also the brain or the blood-brain barrier properties. So we are performing some studies on that as well. But it's really an open field, and we need to look at many different aspects to be able to understand what is going on here. So how can we then use these findings for human health? The really positive thing here is that we can actually change the gut microbiota very easily with diet. We perform studies where we give people a certain food component and the microbiota shifts in just one day. It's very quick, and of course to maintain it you have to continue with feeding your microbes with the food that they want. But we can actually modulate the microbiota to develop new types of prevention strategies, that's what we hope at least, and probably delay the onset of disease, which will be of great benefit. Alzheimer's disease, you usually get symptoms maybe when you're 70 years of age, and if you can delay the onset with 10, 15 years, it would the disease would not get so bad. You wouldn't have so many problems with it. Therapeutics, I believe less in to be able to treat a disease that has already arisen. But it's a possibility, perhaps. So I'll show you a few examples now how dietary factors can change the microbiota and how we use that to optimize health effects. So one food component we have worked a lot with, also together with two researchers in Lund, Coimberg and Lovisa Heyman-Lindén. We have worked a lot with lingonberries, so a Nordic berry, it's found very much here in Sweden and I think in Finland also. And it really shifts the microbiota quite dramatically. So this is mice that were fed either a high-fat diet or a high-fat diet with a supplementation of 20% lingonberries in the diet. And as you can see, the two main groups of bacteria, the Firmicutes and the Bacteroidetes, these are present also in humans. And those are completely shifted when you give mice lingonberries for 8 weeks. And you can see that in the mice that were fed lingonberries, they're given a high-fat diet, and their microbiota composition is really similar to a person who has a lean or normal weight. Whereas the high-fat control-fed mice, their composition is similar to someone who is obese. And that's also what we see in this experiment, that the mice that were fed lingonberries had lower body fat mass, and they had lower low-grade inflammation, lower liver fat. They were just in general a lot healthier. And also interestingly, the lingonberries seem to be able to increase some of the bacteria that we see are decreased in Alzheimer's disease mice. So we are looking further into lingonberries if we can use it for Alzheimer's disease as well. But also we found in continuous study that the microbiota changes that we see induced by the lingonberries were actually associated also with prevention of atherosclerosis. So mice were fed either a low-fat standard diet or a high-fat diet or a high-fat diet with lingonberries. And then the graph shows the amount of atherosclerotic plaques in the heart. And we can really see that we can slow the progression of atherosclerosis by giving the mice lingonberries in the diet. When we looked further, we tried to see what are the mechanisms behind this. And we do have some pieces of the puzzles here. But the question marks are things that we don't know. What we do know is that lingonberries do indeed alter the gut microbiota, and they increase a bile acid enzyme in the liver, CYP7A1. And we think that the microbiota is changing the bile acid metabolism in the gut, and that affects then the bile acid metabolism in the liver as well. And we see in the mice that the blood cholesterol levels, triglyceride levels are decreased. So we think that that's the mechanism for how lingonberries can actually lower the amount of atherosclerotic plaques or prevent the progression of plaques. So currently we have a PhD student who's working with bile acid analysis to see if we can prove this hypothesis. So another food component we have worked with also, quite a pleasant one, it's a byproduct from beer production, barley malt. And in this study, we had a PhD student, Yadong Song. She looked at what happens when you process barley into barley malt. So that is done during beer production. And during the malting process of the barley, you perform a series of germination and heating steps, basically, to change the flavor and the color of the barley, and that is then goes into the beer production. What is interesting here is this is a principal component analysis of the gut microbiota in rats that were fed either barley or barley malt, and we also had control rats given no fiber. And we can see that it really differs whether you process the food. If you malt the barley, you get a completely different microbiota than if you just give barley. And also we could see that the short-chain fatty acid profile, meaning that the bacterial metabolites profile, was a little bit better with the barley malt, actually. So another example of how it really matters what you do with the food that you eat is not just what you eat, but how you have handled it, is heat treatment. Just a regular heat-treated food affects also what kind of microbes you see. This is work done with Elin Dreke. She just took animal food, high-fat diet or low-fat diet, and put it in a regular oven for 12 minutes at 200 degrees, and then we fed it to the mice and compared the differences. And this is a graph showing, it's done with a special analysis called PyCross that maps what kind of microbes that differ and then what kind of genes we know about are being carried by those bacteria. And we can see that the bioavailability seems to be different if you heat treat the food just a little bit. You get a completely different set of microbes if the food is just put in the oven for 10 minutes. So it's something to keep in mind also when we try to change the microbiota with food. We also perform a lot of different tailoring of the physical and chemical properties of dietary fibers. So dietary fibers are our main focus because they are not digested by our own enzymes. Instead, they come down into the colon and are being digested by the gut microbiota. So they are a very good, powerful tool to change the microbiota. So in this study, we took a dietary fiber called guar gum and we changed the viscosity of it to low, medium, or high viscosity to really just see what would happen to the microbiota, what would happen to the health effects of this guar gum. And we looked on diet-induced obesity and metabolites and inflammation and so on. And we fed it to rats for 3 weeks, and we can see that when you give, of course, a dietary fiber, it reduces the weight gain with time. But interestingly, you can see that the lowest viscosity guar gum was good at decreasing the blood cholesterol and triglycerides, while the high viscosity guar gum, it lowered liver fat, liver steatosis, while the medium viscosity guar gum was able to reduce both the liver fat and the blood fat, blood cholesterol. So it's really also important what you do with the viscosity, and again it comes back to the bioavailability of the food for the microbes in the gut, and it really changes the effects of the health effects that you get. So our main future goal now is to use these results to further characterize the microbiota in both people and animal models that have been given different types of tailored or designed food components, especially prebiotics and dietary fibers and fibers from berries, to really prevent these different aspects of the metabolic syndrome, and especially when I'm interested in the neuroinflammatory processes that occur during Alzheimer's disease and also in insulin resistance, you see a cognitive decline that you can maybe also prevent with the diet, we hope. Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this interesting talk. I was wondering about these cholesterol lowering effects. The classical way of reducing cholesterol, one of the ways is to capture the bile acids in the intestine by ion exchange resin. So do you think that this type of effect could be working in the lingonberry stuff, for example, that binds bile acids and it's not reabsorbed and therefore the cholesterol level is...
Yeah, it could be a mechanism like that. We really haven't looked at that kind of mechanism. It's sort of difficult for us. We don't really have methods to go in and really see what's happening there in the gut in that way, but we really want to investigate it further too.
Because that's really the key. Alternative would be that the lingonberry has a specific substance which influences the metabolism.
Yeah, it could definitely be in that way. And we're isolating now different components of the lingonberries to see which component is it that is active and which components can we skip. And then we hope we are able to understand more what the mechanisms are.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Any other questions? Yes, Elias, please.
Thank you very much for this highly interesting talk. So, I would like to ask you a question, since this is an exceptional situation where something has gone wrong in our body system, and it could be caused by something wrong in the microbiome. Is that right?
Yes.
So, do you have an idea how to fix the microbiome? If you would be given the opportunity to try to save someone from outsiders, would you know how to do it by the microbiome, or would you know how to try to do it?
Well, in the mice, we're a little bit further along, so they will really try to specifically change the microbiota in a different direction, really. But in humans, I can't say at all, because we are still analyzing that. But I hope that once we know the differences in the microbiota in Alzheimer's disease patients and healthy, that we will be able to know a little bit what we can do. But it seems like maybe if you have a genetic predisposition to Alzheimer's, it does change the microbiota, and that microbiota maybe is more pro-inflammatory in some way, and then we need to really address that. And I think there's so many different food components that we can really quite easily select those that will give you a certain microbiota. It shouldn't be.
I'm just trying to make the complicated issue as simple as possible. So you say that it's easy to change the microflora of mice. So you have done it. Did it really influence, and to which extent did it influence to the occurrence of Alzheimer's?
Yeah, no, we are just analyzing another animal model of atherosclerosis right now. So yeah, we haven't tested it yet in Alzheimer's disease. So that I don't have any data on yet. We are just now trying to characterize which food components will shift those microbes that we see or might be beneficial in Alzheimer's.
That sounds highly interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Back there, next question.
I'm a little bit confused. Should I let my dog to lick me?
Sorry?
Should I let my dog to lick my face? Should I kiss my mother? She had Alzheimer's. She had the same diet like me, basically. You understand? There are a lot of questions. Mice is mice. There were many, many studies. So these mice are far away. Okay? Now, to control microbiota, I change it every day. Every half a day I can change it. Not in the big mice, but I can change it. Another issue that I just raised for you, which is an interesting question, I don't believe in probiotics. There is a big industry of probiotics. You know, 1 million bacteria in one capsule. I found out that it doesn't help us. I work on this issue. For the company, it's very good, they are selling, but the results are... I mean, we have to understand much more in depth.
Yes, yes.
I think that they control us, you know what I mean? We are living around the bacteria. Not the opposite, they are not inside us. Basically, there are much more bacteria than our cells. I don't even know the Weizmann Institute, his last study on microbiomes and so on, nature. But they show different stuff, exactly what you pointed at. It's a really basic question that we have to go in depth.
Yes, yeah.
Because what I think, we just prior to your lecture, we hear something else. It's not contradictory. You say outside, no bacteria, no outside. So what should they do? Be steroid?
No, of course not. So the mouse model that is germ-free is just to sort of bring the attention that microbes are actually important for this disease.
Yeah.
Then you continue and perform more in-depth testing to really understand what's going on here.
Yeah. I'm asking this question as a scientist, not I'm asking myself, where am I going? Okay, very nice presentation. Well, I mean, the results are amazing. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. And if there were more questions, we just thank you once more.